Thanks for joining me on this Switchvox Getting Started for Administrators. Now that your new Switchvox is up and running, there are some preliminary tasks we'll want to run through before we continue with the configuration and setup of the Switchvox PBX. In order to do this, we'll need to log into the admin console interface at the IP address or FQDN of the Switchvox system /admin. Unless otherwise specified, the default username is admin, default password is admin, unless you've been provided something in place or you've set something else up during the on-prem installation. So I'll see you on the other side of the login page so we can get started. And I'm Matt with Sangoma, and thanks for joining me on this Switchvox training series. Now that we've logged into our Switchvox instance, it's likely that rather than this overview page, you'll be presented with a change password page. You can go ahead and update your admin password and continue until you get to this screen. Our first admin task though will be finding that admin password change section so that you can do so at any time if you need to update that. We'll go to setup, and under admins, you can go to my account. Now there are some minimum requirements for passwords, so let's get that out of the way. You'll see here that it must be 8 to 64 characters and contain a mix of upper and lower case, digits, and special characters. I can toggle on minimalist mode, which will lighten the interface, for example if you have low bandwidth requirements or perhaps you are attempting to access the interface from a mobile device, you can enable that and remove a lot of the extra textures, fonts, and CSS, and so on. Okay, so what if we want to add additional admins to the Switchvox system? We can go back up to Setup, and Admins Manage. Create Admin. We'll have our login name. Same password requirements here. Language and location. The forced change of password on next login, of course, is what we just discussed, that the user will need to change their password when they first log in. One thing to note is if you are a hosted Switchvox user, you will only have read access to the admin section at the time of this recording, so you'll need to reach out to your account representative if you'd like to modify or add additional administrators. You'll notice the permissions tab just on the right side. We can go down the list of permissions and fine-grain those for this particular admin that we're setting up. I'm going to start with the basic three, which are none, read-only, and read-write. There are additional settings and parameters for each one of these permission groups. If I just click on the column, I may want read-only, but I may want to allow read-write for groups, for example, on the extensions. Similar, you can go down the list and adjust those as needed for this particular admin's role. Now I've allowed them to read and write, essentially to do backups on the system. And now our new admin is set up. The next item is this notification bar at the top. I currently have two urgent notifications. Now this bar will not go away until I address these specific issues. I'm going to go ahead and click to view. The first notification pertains to a security concern in the access control. The all networks, which is essentially the external network, is allowing web portal access for both admins and users and the API service. Now, if I do have users that need to access the web interface from the external side, I would likely have this rule remain intact. We'll go into access control in greater detail in another video titled Network Connectivity. So I'm going to go ahead and dismiss this warning. That leaves us with one. No E911 locations defined. In order to remove this notification, we'll have to create a phone location. The purpose of the phone location is to depict where this group of phones is physically located. While this doesn't necessarily apply only to physical phones, the main purpose is for physical phone locations for hot desking and E911 purposes. Since several users use hot desking on a particular phone, we want to know where that phone's location is, so no matter which user makes the call, they'll share the same outgoing caller ID number. This outgoing caller ID number is also presented within an E911 call, although the location information is not sent. Rather, the caller ID would be tied to some 911 location, which is done at the carrier level generally, or if you're a SIP station customer, this can be done at the SIP station admin portal. So I'll give it a name and a caller ID, and I'll leave these emergency call rules for this location at their default. The phone locations can be allocated to phone settings per extension, extension templates, and a few other places within the Switchvox ecosystem. As we go through other videos in this series, such as creating extensions, the phone location will come up as a reference point. That's why we're addressing this now in the Getting Started video. Another task I like to perform on a new installation of Switchvox is to set the system clock by heading over to Server, Maintenance, System Clock. Now, this time is generally set up with the Linux OS during installation, or if you're a cloud Switchvox user, this will be set for you, generally based on your needed time zone. So you won't have access to modify it here, so you want to reach out to your rep or support to do that. But no matter what scenario you're in, take a look and make sure that this is all set up correctly for your physical location or the one that you prefer. The timestamp can be seen throughout the Switchvox system in places such as call and system logs, recording dates, voicemails, etc., bearing in mind that users can set the time zone for their particular profiles. If they want something different than here, that can also be set in user templates. You could certainly choose your own NTP server if you'd like. Bear in mind that whether you're using the default one or your own, make sure that you've created a firewall rule that allows that NTP traffic to go in and out of your server. Another common task we'll want to be aware of from the get-go is how to log in as a user or a pseudo login so that we can better assist our users when they make support requests or they need changes that we're doing on their behalf. Let's go to Setup and Extension Management. I've got a user here. The first icon under the Actions column will be log in as this user. Now I'm logged in just as if the user logged in themselves. I can now make changes, view extension specific information, and so on. Another important admin task would be system health monitoring and doing health checks. I'm back on the homepage of the Switchvox dashboard, and you can see here that I've got some information regarding just that. The ability to update the Switchvox, the server information such as memory, disk space available, and some quick stats on the right side such as my VoIP providers and the extension count for users in call queue. If you're a Switchvox cloud user, you may only have read-only capabilities for some of this information, such as the disk usage, and other system information will not be available at all, such as the server utilization of memory and load, as well as any updates, which will be taken care of in the background for you. Keeping an eye on disk usage is important for recording storage, backup storage, and making sure that we have enough available space. We can either click the link right on the homepage here, but we can also go up to Server, and under Diagnostics, we have disk usage here. This will give us a good oversight of the disk usage breakdown, and we can specifically hone in on how much is media, such as music on hold, sound prompts, call recordings are over next to that. And this will let us know if we're running out of disk space, of course, to adjust perhaps our thresholds for things like voicemails and call recordings. Or if you're a cloud user, you want to make sure that you're using FTP backups for your recordings, which we'll get to in the next video, System Health and Maintenance. Mailbox usage breakdown will show you how much of the disk usage is split among the users and what the quota is for those users. If a user has a high usage compared to other users, perhaps you would consider allocating a higher quota for that particular user depending on their needs. This disk usage settings tab gives us some control over chat file attachments, the retention period for call logs, queues, and mailbox content. This can also be done on a individual user level through the extension management or the extension template management. Okay. Another common feature used by both cloud and prem users of Switchvox would be IP blocking management. There is a built-in mechanism, IP blocking, a security feature of the built-in Switchvox firewall that will block nefarious actors. Sometimes it does happen that IPs will be blocked that shouldn't be blocked due to failed password attempt thresholds, likely indicating some wider user problems. If you need to manage or unblock an IP, including your own, you can head to Server, Networking, and Blocked IPs for a full list. You can see here, I already have 137 within just a matter of days, mainly for failed SIP registration. Now I haven't yet secured the SIP port from external on my system, which will come up later in the access control section of another video. However, if you have remote users to the system, or of course if you're a cloud user, everything will be remote. In that case, you can expect that these bad actors will be banned. And if we do want to manage that IP, I've got two options under the actions column. I can view the details or unblock. Starting with view details, I can see here that this IP attempted to log in with SIP unsuccessfully 5 times and they were banned as a result. I can simply click unblock and that IP will be unblocked. If you do lock yourself out of the Switchvox system, you wouldn't have access to the interface, so you'll need to access the interface through another IP address in order to do so. It would undoubtedly be a huge help if the Switchvox was proactive and let us know when there was issues that arose, so we don't always have to log in to notice any problems. Well, luckily that's the case with notifications. If we head up to Tools under Notifications and take a look at the Alerts Manager, we have just a system here. Under Subscriptions, we can create an alert subscription. Simply enter the name and email of the person who will receive specific or all of the notifications that you want to include. So we have issues creating or transferring backups, issues with call recordings, notices when there's an emergency number that's dialed, such as a requirement also in the E911. Then we've got issues pertaining to faxes, peered switchboxes, scheduled reports, security, also that system load and disk space, and any issues pertaining to saving voicemails. I'll go ahead and set up an alert. So I've set up alert levels for error warning and info. Of course, I can modify these if I just want to know about the errors themselves and not get more frequent notifications for things that aren't crucial, critical, etc. Alert logs would be housed here, so that at any time I can come back into the system and get a handle on what exactly the troubles were within this time period. So here I've got warnings related to failed login attempts. So I'm also getting alerts about changes on the system if I'd like to go through some aspects of the change log of the system itself and kind of look back at to if there was any changes that might be affecting the performance, or if something's not working anymore, I can go back and see some of the change history. The last getting started topic I have for you is the help resources. A very handy feature will be this little question mark next to various titles and sections of each page, which contains help directly related to that page or feature. Secondly, you can reach the Sangoma knowledge base by heading up top to the profile and clicking on help, which pops up the Switchvox knowledge base in full. You can also visit help.sangoma.com and you can find the Switchvox section on the homepage, and you can also use the search bar to type in various questions. In addition to that, there is technical support under server. We'll cover best practices for support, including gathering pertinent information to your issues in a later video. We can see here, we have the ability to enable the remote tech support access, the registration code to provide, and a VPN connection for support to tunnel in should you be requested to do so. Okay, so those are some of the main important tasks that you'll do as an admin on a regular basis, and I hope that creates a good foundation so we can move forward. Next up, we'll discuss system health and maintenance, and I look forward to seeing you there.